Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of Fallen Angels by Patricia Hickman, narrated by John McDonough. This book is copyrighted 2003 by Patricia Hickman. This recording is copyrighted 2003 by Recorded Books. Jeb Nubey is on the run from the law, and three abandoned children are going to be his saving grace. When Jeb leads the Welby siblings into the town of Nazareth, they're all mistaken for the long-awaited Reverend Gracie and his children. What unfolds is a remarkable tale of love, hardship, and redemption. And now, Fallen Angels.
Chapter 1. A bit of trouble with attempted murder sent Jeb Nubey over the Texarkana border in the unfortunate direction of hunger. Everybody from the Texas side had gotten the wrong idea about the matter. If he had been a man of means, he would have been thought of as a stand-up guy instead of feller on the run. That was all stand-up men were, he figured, the ones who could stand up with their pockets full of payoffs and get fellers to see things in a new light. But now, none of the itinerant boys, buddies he'd on many nights shared a bottle of the good stuff with, would talk to him. Once word spread of problems with the boss man, they just turned their sorry backs and walked away. He'd never thought he would hear his name preceded by no account, as in no account scum, no account filth of the earth, worthless, shiftless. 22 years after his mama had given him the good name of Jeb, he'd descended to the rank Leon Hampton had awarded him, Leon and his son Hank, who could never keep a gal on his tight-fisted leash due to his alcohol-infused temper. The gal, Myrna, the Betty Boop gal, round hips, red lips. Last night, I nearly killed a man. Maybe I did kill him. Now no one will talk to me, said Jeb. Hank got what's coming to him, Jeb's brother, Charlie, said. But you got to hide. Lay low until things simmer down in Texarkana, until Hampton forgets your name. Hampton's owned everything in Texarkana, from the burlesque girls, no one admitted worked for a nickel a dance down at the Biscuit and Bean, to the banking king who kept his doors open on Black Monday when the other savings and loans had closed. It's cowardly, Charlie. I ain't a running away sort, Jeb said. Charlie packed up 2 work shirts, along with all the cash the two of them had earned picking cotton, and handed it all to Jeb. That's why Hank's laying near to death, because you don't run away. He came at you first. We all saw it. But you got them killer fists. Charlie gave the air between them a hefty punch, and then handed him the bag he'd filled with the cash and such. We don't have no clout in Texarkana. Without clout, you got no witnesses, not none that a body would listen to. Jeb wondered if Charlie had finally lost every bit of good sense. Hank would have killed you too, Charlie, if he'd caught you with her. Don't give me eyes. I knowed you'd slept with Myrna like we all did. Jeb had memorized Myrna. Myrna, the girl that pretended she loved him when she loved most of the starving gaggle of sharecroppers' sons in Texarkana. Sweet skin, like the girls that posed for the better calendars. Paled by the blue of night, her hair spread against the hay bale, flaxen corn silk like the breath of moon and stars. Touched by Jeb. Myrna had her own perfume, and the kind of girl's fragrant hair that wrapped her white dewy shoulders with an aroma like petals. Mind fogging. But not worth a killing. It was you, brother, that did the doing. I didn't, don't you see? Charlie's face gentled, faultless. We never. You know I got Selma waiting for me in Oklahoma. You expect me to believe you're keeping yourself for Selma? I believe that like I believe we's going to wake up a Rockefeller. Myrna loved you, Jeb. Said you cast a spell over her. Told me that over a bowl of beans. Now, if that don't mean something, nothing does. Jeb knew the truth. She never belonged to Hank. Gals like her don't belong to nobody. He shook out the insides of the bag and stuffed Charlie's money into a leather satchel his grandfather had once toted across the plains. He listened to the bearish sounds of the sleeping itinerant workers, hard sleepers fallen on their cots from a week of picking. Blood dried on bowl-torn fingertips, perfumed by corn liquor. You think Hank will die for real? He could not breathe himself. Either way, his daddy's gone after the sheriff. You got to get out of here. Charlie's face was wet with worry. If I leave, they'll believe I meant to do him in. I stay, they at least hear my side. You got no clout. Stop saying that, Charlie, like I got no name. Hampton's hound dogs bayed. The moon had a faded paleness, as though a candle inside its glass was melting before sunup. I never meant to kill him, Charlie. If he dies, I should be hanged. You listen to me, and you listen like I'm our mama. Give us some time, me and the boys, to talk to the sheriff. Otherwise, they could string you up and gut you before you can even whisper your own name. Hamptons, they got money. That sheriff listens to money. It calls his name. But if we all get to him before the story gets turned around, blown into more than it was, I'll send for you. I don't know where to go, Charlie. Just where do cowards hide? Find a big place with lots of people. Hot Springs. Little Rock. No, that's the first place they'll look. Best you don't tell me. But after you get settled, write. How you expect me to do that? Don't put your name on it like, here I am, come and get me, police. Both of them stared at the floor, locked in place and out of ideas. Disgraceful shame. Good schemers, but between the two of them, kind of low on dependable means. I tell you what, just draw a big X on the letter. Have the postman stamp it with the town name. Lay low. I'll find you when it's safe. The whole desertion mess started in the Rialto Theater in Camden, Arkansas. The warm lap of summer brought out the townsfolk to the dance like they'd been spring-dosed with yarbs. Angel figured the Washita's old ballroom dance hall across the street had lured in the wrong kind of man to draw her Aunt Lana's wandering eye. Lana, who wasn't really her aunt anyway, only a conniving woman, of a mind to do her daddy's errands only so she could keep food in her belly. "Aunt my hind foot," her mother might have said, if she herself had stuck around. Saturday night at the movies in Camden fed hungry imaginations a front-row view of the American dream. Pin-up girls lolled poolside on the big screen, California smiles as bright as morning light, trickling across the Washita River. In the Arkansas movie theater, Angel closed her eyes to imagine the California sun warming her unshapely legs, tickling her calves until they turned heads, brown and never-ending like tall, elegant sequoias. Forever legs, she imagined. Then she opened her eyes, palely 13 again, and deserted in the Rialto with her little brother Willie and her younger sister Ida May. Two kids, a big girl with her younger brother, sat in front of them, not in the least bit interested in Barbara Stanwyck or that glamour gal's rendering of a charlatan evangelist. With the movie screen for a halo, the girl turned around in the threadbare chair and stared at Angel and her siblings, curious and bored. The girl, her hair pigtailed to distraction, pressed another jelly bean between her lips that puckered when she spoke, as though she had practiced the Shirley Temple pucker too long at a mirror. She glanced up the aisle and then back at Angel. "Where'd your mama go to?" "None of your business," said Angel. She leaned right and slightly cocked her head. "She ain't our mama. She's Aunt Lana," said Willie. Angel gave him a sort of tap in the arm with her elbow. "Don't say ain't." She hated being marked an archy, even though every farmer, bank clerk, and soda jerk in sight fit the type. The kind of people who drift into the middle of the nation, lose their wind, and stay. To Angel, saying ain't was like saying, "I give up and can't get no smarter." But worse was hearing Willie mix mama with Aunt Lana. Angel talked about everybody and everything, but not mama. It was the kind of thing she kept to herself, as though someday the secret would bring the two of them closer. Her mama, Thorne, had disappeared into a Ford with two women who traveled to Little Rock to try and find work. Angel had stared after her, held on to her eyes, a pair of exotic browns like the kind that belonged to Bronzy Island girls. Eyes that set off her luxurious hair tendriling out of the window. With her mama had left the only opulence that lingered in Snow Hill, the only hope that Angel would someday be as elegant as Thorne, drove off to Little Rock with a promise to send money. Lemuel, her father, had too often of late paid more attention to a neighbor divorcee named Lana than his own kin. With Thorne run off to Little Rock, he finally packed the kids all off, aimed in the general direction of the town of Angel's oldest sister, Claudia, a place called Nazareth. But of all the foolish ideas Daddy had ever dreamed up, sending them off with Lana took the cake. "Where is Aunt Lana?" Willie shared his popcorn with Ida May, trying to keep her in her own seat and out of his. "She's not our aunt. How many times I have to say it?" said Angel. She knew that Daddy thought that if he had the little ones call her aunt, her every other day appearances at the front door would give her full authority over the young'uns. But Angel knew better. Daddy had underestimated his girl. "I think she run off with that huckster nosing around the hotel and left us here. If Daddy knew, he'd bean her." Willie picked Ida May off his shoulder and deposited her on the other side of the chair arm. "What's a huckster?" Ida May tried to curl up against her brother again. "A peddler who ain't a bona fide person of worth." Angel disappeared into the screen again, into the sin of Barbara Stanwyck, the miracle woman. The motion picture had finally made it into Arkansas. When Willie tried to speak again, Angel shushed him, a slow hissing that seeped out of her as she followed Miss Stanwyck across the screen. Angel made them stay until the last credit rolled up and away. The house lights brightened slow and easy, turning the wallpaper red as lipstick. "Let's try and find Lana," said Willie. Angel rolled up Willie's popcorn bag, tucked it under her arm, and herded the others out into the lobby. Once she thought she heard Lana's high, squeaky cackle, the same one she heard at night out on their front porch when Daddy sent them off to bed. But Lana was nowhere to be found. Across the street from the Rialto, a steady stream of couples clambered up the steps and across the mezzanine of the Washita Hotel to the grand ballroom, where a live band played. Most of Camden had turned out for the dance. The threesome headed out into the street and searched the crowd for what seemed like an hour. Finally, Angel turned to face the younger ones. The Rialto's neon marquee buzzed overhead. "Let's face it, Willie. Lana's gone. She ditched us." Ida May huffed. "Did not." "Willie, you stay down here next to this couple. Make like they're our folks until I get back, for safety. Stop looking at me like that. I'll check out the dance." Angel sidled up the steps to the landing. It led across the alley to the ballroom. She could see couples swaying across the hardwood floors, but no Lana. She met Willie and Ida May downstairs again and led them to Usher's drugstore on the corner of Washington and Adams, where she helped Ida May onto a stool. She made Willie stay with her while she crept past the faces reflecting back at her from the long, ornate mirror behind the soda bar. Moments later, Willie found her in the back and ran at her red-faced.
"That soda jerk told us if we ain't ordering, we have to leave."
"Lana's not here either. Let's go," said Angel.
"Go where, Angel?"
Instead of acting scared, Willie got mad.
"Back to Snow Hill? To Claudia's? Where?"
"Hush. Don't be a rat, Willie. You got to give me time to think." Ida May waited like a ghost in the doorway, jostled aside by paying customers. Her face was oval with brown eyes like her mother's. When upset, the oval got all long-like, hardening her eyes like penny candies. Her mama had always said, "Little girl, you'll turn to salt and blow away making faces like that." Ida May stood in the doorway, her mouth an O. Angel hated the way the depression toughened girl babies and made them old before their time. Angel examined the town in front of her. First off, Camden was more electrified than Snow Hill. The Camdenites gathered in clusters in front of the movie theater, some in front of Usry's drugstore, and a lot of the people dressed for Saturday night showing off. They clamored in and out of the ballroom, little ants spilling out of a thrown-away Coke bottle. The young women all wore hats that snugged to their heads like colored helmets. The whole place had a pace contrary to Snow Hill. By this time of night, Snow Hill had rolled up inside of itself, an old man glad for the day to be over and done with.
"If we don't find Lana, where will we go tonight? Where will we sleep or eat? Lana didn't check us into the motel like she said she was fixing to do," said Willie.
"We'll find a room. I'm no louse when it comes to figuring things out, Willie. I can take care of things as good or better than Lana. I am 13, after all." Angel took Ida May's hand and led her down past the hotel and across the street to the Rialto. She tapped the counter to attract the ticket seller's attention.
"Excuse me, mister. I got something to ask," she said.
The ticket seller lifted his eyes and revealed a long, thin face with a chin that protruded like a potato.
"Yes. What you children want?"
"I'm supposed to meet my aunt. She's getting us a room. Know where she might get us a room?"
Willie mumbled behind her. The ticket seller pointed at the Washita Hotel.
"Only one place."
With one graceful, popcorn-oiled hand, Ida May pointed toward the hotel.
"I see her, Angel. Look, there she is yonder."
Ida May bristled past her older sister, who had failed her as a stand-in leader. Angel chased her across the street through the gaggle of humans from the hills and lake that encircled Camden proper. Willie ran past her, charged up the hotel stairs, and barreled past the mezzanine.
"Angel, it's not Lana,"
he called from the opening to the ballroom. The music blared above his nasal yell. Angel reached the doorway and looked in at the mass of swaying bodies. A woman, blonde, bore Lana's posture, hips forward, shoulders slumped. The woman gingerly held up a cigarette for a man to light. She drew on it. The tobacco end warmed and kindled red like coals coming to life. The blonde leaned toward him and whispered into his ear. Then she turned and walked away from him, as though she had excused herself to the powder room.
"It's not Lana, Ida May," said Willie.
Ida May had by now twisted Angel's skirt around her pointer finger.
"I'm scared, Angel."
"I'll get us a room. We'll get some shut-eye and then figure out what to do tomorrow." Angel led them across the mezzanine and down into the hotel lobby.
"I didn't like her anyway," Willie said. "Matter of fact, she made me sick, come to think of it. She told lies about Mama."
Angel paused, remembering how Lana had said, "It's a hard thing to hear. Your mama had to be taken off to stay with her sister, who could care for her better. Don't think that means she didn't love you kids. She loved you all right. But this depression is enough to drive any person over the ledge." She'd spewed it out inside the Rialto after pacifying Ida May with popcorn. "Then strap on too many mouths to feed and you got trouble. Your mother went and leaped off the cliffs of insanity, that's what. They call it stark raving mad." Lana disappeared after that. Angel decided to run into the powder room to smooth the bleeding rivulets of color on her lower lip. "She tells lies, Willie, when it's easier to tell the truth." Angel approached the front desk. She lied to the clerk about meeting her aunt. When Willie showed the clerk hard cash, he didn't seem to mind. He handed Angel the key. "Back up the stairs, down the hall, and third door on the right. You kids would do best to remember we like it quiet after midnight." Angel took the key and started up the stairs. Ida May took every step as though she expected Lana to appear and give an account for her delay. Willie beat them to the door and waited while Angel used the key and opened the door. "I'm hungry again," said Willie. The first thing he did was to riffle through the nightstand drawer as though he might find a candy or two left behind by a former hotel customer. "Ida May, you wash up in the lavatory and climb into bed with Willie. I'll take the extra bed near the wall." Angel stopped for the first time and examined the lay of the room. The hotel room had wallpaper, genuine wallpaper, not magazine pages stuck to the wall. The first that Angel had ever seen. Her mother might have called it elegant, a swirl of gold and red that twinkled in the chandelier's light like a kaleidoscope. "This is a pretty nice place." In the bathroom, Ida May ran the sink water until Angel yelled for her to shut it off and get in bed. After making sure Ida May and Willie were covered up good, Angel slid her mother's old satin nightgown out of the sack and pulled it on top of herself. She whispered twice, "Lana's a liar," and fell asleep. She dreamed dreams of Barbara Stanwyck perched on a platform, the charlatan queen who touched her flock with her healing lies. The actress's features disappeared, and Angel's face took Stanwyck's place. Her stomach was stretched full, satisfied with delicacies paid for by the faithful. She lifted her arms as though she possessed a power from above. The divine gesture caused the loyal to toss money onto the platform. She moved across the stage with her gown trailing behind her and dollar bills crunching beneath her slippers. When she awoke to the sound of voices in the hallway, the first thing to draw her eye was Ida May, staring out of the window into the alley below. Lana had never come back. A deputy sheriff stopped Willie and Ida May out on the sidewalk. "I don't believe I know you kids. Who's your mama?" Angel pushed through two people to get to them and lead Ida May away from the policeman before she gave away more than was needed.
"I'm calling Daddy," said Ida May.
And then she yanked away from Angel and ran down the street away from the Washita. Angel trailed behind her until she saw her disappear into a storefront. Inside, Ida May crouched behind a flower display.
"You can't call Daddy. You lost your mind?"
Angel was entirely disgusted. Willie caught up with them, and the two younger children stood looking at the eldest. Angel hated to tell them, but finally broke down.
"He took off soon as Lana drove away with us." "How you know that?"
Willie's fingers followed the X's on the threads inside a basket of baseballs.
"I saw his things packed up. His job was spent. He's headed for work down in Texas. Lana told me. That's why she left. Her gravy train was drying up. The only reason she hauled us off was because Daddy gave her a little money for it. He should have known she was brainless and likely to ditch us."
Willie fished around inside the bag Lana had left in the theater.
"What do you think you'll find?" Angel asked. "Lana hid a little money in here yesterday. Flighty gals like her forget their own names once they get their minds on other things, like that huckster."
He fished out a scarf tied with string. Angel untied the scarf and opened it.
$5, plus what Daddy give us.
I'm glad she's gone. We can get to Claudia's by ourselves. Claudia should have gotten her letter by now, Angel decided. Her memory of an older sister was little more than a grown-up laugh in the kitchen with Mama. Claudia had not been one to write, but often enough she had dropped a note to tell Mama about her marriage to a railway man. She never said either way whether he treated her good. She just said the bills were paid, and that was all the good in a man she needed.
"I don't think Daddy left at all. You're just saying it to get us to do what you want. I want to go home, Angel. We never heard nothing from Claudia. She doesn't know we're coming. What if she can't afford to feed us like Daddy couldn't?" asked Willie. "Home's not home anymore, and I'm not lying. Besides, Claudia knows about Mama. I wrote her a letter and told her. Daddy said he'd write and tell her we were headed her way, so stop complaining."
A lady with a natural smile counted apples into a basket next to them.
"Ma'am, we need to catch a lift to our sister's place in Nazareth. We'd be glad to pay you a dollar for the trouble," said Angel. "Where would you kids get a dollar? Don't believe I've ever seen you around here."
The woman's entire expression changed as though a cloud had all at once formed above her.
"Oh, we got it from our daddy."
Angel backed away from the woman. She remembered the way the deputy sheriff had fixed his eyes on her, as though he were putting her face to memory.
"Let's go over to that cafe and get us something to eat, Angel," Willie begged. "I'm starving."
Angel ignored her brother and studied a male customer who gathered food into a crate. He turned and glanced at them and returned to his shopping.
"There's a man that looks like he's about to do some traveling. Let's see if he'll take a couple of dollars for letting us hitch a ride."
$2 is too much," said Willie.
The man in denim bent over a stacked crate of canned goods next to his collected heap of flour and sugar. He looked a lot like the feller who broke ponies down at the auction barn in Snow Hill. Nice face bones, but a little troubled around the eyes. He tapped each can, counting and recounting as though he could not remember the number of the items. Angel had not known many fellas with eyes so thread blue, like the stitches on her daddy's work pants. Sweet creases at the corners, but not so badly aged, although they made him look puckish. Angel gave her hair a combing through her fingertips. It came to her that she should cast herself in the best light possible to sweet eyes. She composed herself in the manner of a near-grown girl and said, "Excuse me, sir."
"I don't have anything for beggar kids," he said.
"You don't know who I am?"
She pulled on her earlobe whenever she lied, a habit her daddy had always called her on. Angel was not a name to give a girl who told her kind of lies. But anyone in her situation had to have resources or resort to invention. Through the storefront window, she saw a Ford truck parked near the door, and she noticed the decent set of tires, like Daddy always did.
"My father is, well, he's the right-hand man to Henry Ford."
The apple counter stopped her counting and stared at Angel. Angel spoke more quietly.
"Matter of fact, Henry Ford's my uncle."
She noticed how the man's eyes thinned, two rinds. He assessed her tattered green dress, the loose braiding at the yoke. She pressed the loopy part against her chest with one finger.
"Our better clothes are at the hotel, being washed."
"You're staying at the hotel?" Sweet Eyes asked. The key was still in Angel's pocket. She held it up.
"The Washita, of course. Nothing but the best, Daddy says.
Anyway, Daddy sent us ahead to visit relatives, and truth be told, our mistress done got herself sick with the flu. Flu's been going around like nobody's business. Poor lady.
What relatives? Asked Sweet Eyes.
Our older sister Claudia, said Angel. That was not a lie. She's married with a kid or two. Old enough to take us in, I reckon.
Willie stood holding his hat. As though coached by Angel, he hung his head. Ida May bit her lip. She had been on the very edge of bawling all morning, so her lip quivered just by the very act of anyone looking at her.
We're stranded as can be, but we got the money to pay our own way. If you think you could give us a ride to a place called Nazareth, we'll pay.
She held out a single crisp dollar bill, considering Willie's caution that $2 was too much.
I don't know what you got for an angle, but I'm traveling alone, and I don't have any place to put kids.
Sweet Eyes glanced up at the Ford pickup loaded with food and supplies. Besides, if your daddy works for Ford, you should give him a call and tell him you're in dire need of his assistance. The man's crackling voice rose in pitch. His attention drifted, and then he lost interest altogether.
Excuse me, did I hear you say you're traveling to Nazareth?
A woman in a shapeless dress hovered near the apple crates, listening to everything Angel had said. Her skin had a pink cast, blending into whiter eye sockets with feathery white brows for a topper.
I'm Winifred Mock. I'm a retired schoolteacher, and I'm on my way to Bluff City. Appears to me Nazareth is a rock's throw from Bluff City. You say you'll pay for the ride?
Angel held up the dollar.
There's three of you?
She counted them with her nose. Angel pulled out the second dollar.
There you have it, a ride with a retired school teacher, said Sweet Eyes. He jerked a crate up and arched his back to brace the weight of the flour and sugar bags.
Angel watched him pay and leave.
We need to find a place to eat, she said to Winifred. My brother and sister need some breakfast, and then we'll be ready to leave.
Best to grab some bread and apples then here at the store. You can eat in my car on the way, long as you mind not to clutter it up.
Small relief spilled over, and Angel said,
I told you I could take care of us, Willie.
She gathered a whole loaf of bread, a half dozen apples, and laid them on the counter. A paying customer.
Winifred Mock whirred in a monotone. She droned instead of conversing, and it occurred to Angel the woman had a terrible way of talking. She strung her syllables out, running words into other words, until the whole of her sentence became a sticky lump of tedious slurs.
How long did you teach school? Angel finally asked her.
20 years, only it sounded like 20 years.
Winifred pulled a cigarette from her cumbersome black purse, a bag so deep it reminded Angel of Doc Campbell's medical bag in Snow Hill. Inside, beside a pair of red gloves, Angel saw a deck of cards.
My uncle plays poker. You a poker player, Miss Mock?
Angel asked. The woman reached and closed the bag with a snap.
Your uncle? You mean your Uncle Henry Ford the millionaire?
Angel tugged her right earlobe.
You don't have to keep up the front on my account. You kids orphans are some such, I figure. You really got family in Nazareth, or you just looking for the next meal ticket?
Winifred's cigarette pulsed in Morse code beats when she spoke.
We're not orphans!
Willie sat up from the rear seat. His annoyance blustered out of him, and he grabbed the back of the seat to pull himself forward.
Fine, fine, you're not orphans, said Winifred. I guess you right about it. You got money. Least you had some before you gave it to me. How you come by the money for this trip?
We got almost $10, and we're not orphans, said Willie.
Winifred stared straight ahead.
I'm glad you got means. Shame to see children like you without means.
Things'll pick up for us in Nazareth,
said Angel.
You must have a good little wad to be traveling on your own.
We don't have that much anymore. Our aunt, that is the lady who dumped us, ran off with all our money, said Angel. It came to her they ought not to give out particulars that were nobody's business.
Folks like that ought to be tied up and left for the crows, said Winifred.
Ida May huffed, an anxious dove sigh that drew her sister's eye.
You don't look old enough to take care of two little ones, said Winifred.
I'm 13, Angel told her, and it was true.
Old enough to marry, they say. I guess you'll do then. I need to go bad, said Ida May. Course you do, honey. It's been a while since I've been around little ones. Best to remind me of things like that. I'll pull over and you can find you a place to go out in this field. No one around. Your sister can take you.
The car rolled to a stop.
Come with me, Ida May. Willie, you just wait here, I guess.
Where are we? Willie asked Winifred.
Somewhere between Camden and Chittister, said Winifred.
Angel, who had kept the sack full of their belongings in her arms, opened Willie's door and handed him the bag of apples and leftover bread.
Ida May, let's go. You take too long.
Out of all the Welbys, Ida May always took the trophy for being the household sissy. She had grown up around outhouses, but never wanted to go into one. Many nights Angel had stood outside the sharecropper's outhouse at midnight, listening to her sister sniffle and complain about odors and wild things looking to grab a body. This field, with its prickly weeds, offered Ida May a whole new crop of complaints.
I hate this place. I can't go here, Angel. I want to go home, said Ida May.
Ida May, you hate doing your business back home, too. Just go.
She opened the sack containing the money and counted the roll of bills again. A faint sigh lifted from the bramble. Ida May emerged as though all her self-respect had been left in the weeds. Angel pushed back a stalk of goldenrod and let Ida May pass. When they entered the clearing, Willie waved to them from behind the car.
Miss Mark's car won't start. You all get in and I'll push it.
Like you're the one with all the muscles.
Angel helped Ida May into the back seat.
Hold on to this bag.
She closed the door.
Sometimes this car is hard to start up if I let it set too long.
Winifred lit another cigarette.
You think your little brother can give it a push while I gun the engine?
Angel climbed into the front passenger seat.
Give it a go, Willie.
Winifred turned the key and pumped the gas pedal. Willie pushed against the rear bumper, but the car didn't move. Angel opened her door and joined him at the rear bumper. The car made a grinding sound and then an exploding roar. Angel looked up and saw Ida May staring at them from the side of the road. Angel yelled, "Get back in the Ford!" The car engine turned over and Winifred took off.
"She's leaving us!"
Angel saw that Ida May was empty-handed.
"Where is the bag, Ida May?"
"In the car. That Miss Mock yelled and made me get out. You didn't hear it? She scared me half to death. I think she's lost her mind."
Ida May watched the car disappear around a turn.
"I'm glad she's gone."
Angel and Willie stared at one another.
"The money, Ida May! I knew something was strange about her the minute I laid eyes on her. Who ever heard of a poker-playing school teacher? We're busted, don't you see?"
The hardness of Ida May's eyes dissolved, and she cried.
"Angel, you got to stop yelling," said Willie. "She even took our food. We don't have a blessed thing, not nary a thing to our name, and here we are stuck in the middle of nowhere."
Angel started walking like she might just leave Ida May on the side of the road. She put on an I don't care face, but watched from the corner of her eye to make sure the little chicks followed. The day was still new enough. She'd have to study about how they might survive through another ruinous day. The outskirts of Nazareth, sunned in the foothills of the Washita Mountains, just a leap and a skip before Hope and Texarkana. The road strung out like a dusty snake of clay and rock. Angel led them across a field and down a little road that paralleled the main road. Not too far down the road, she found relief in knowing that other young'uns had been put out. Three boys stamped along hurling rocks and fighting. She watched them knock on a door and beg for food. Knowing that about the road colored her ideas about Daddy.
"When folks are hungry, the first thing to go is the family dog," she complained to Willie.
She did not mean to infer that they ate the dog, but Willie got a picture of just that in his head and told her so.
"That's what cannibals do, Willard. Don't be a goof." Willie said, "I don't want you to ever call me that again, Angel Minerva Welby. You know I hate it."
Angel smiled at him, owning everything that was said.
"Here's the way it lays, Willie boy. You can just stop feeding the dog, and then he takes off to go and fend for himself. But the second thing to go is the ones who don't rake in the dough. I got this little deal all figured out. If you have too many mouths to feed, you send out your oldest. With John and Daryl dead, and Claudia married off, I was the next best choice to be put out. It's common sense. The way things go, Daddy did best he could by us. But me and Ida May saw how you cried and shoved your raggedy underthings into a paper bag. Daddy did wrong by us."
"I didn't cry." Willie cocked his head to the side, but he didn't argue. Angel remembered that black crease around Daddy's eyes that coal miners acquire down in those caves of death. He had worked the mines down in Paris, Arkansas, until he had saved enough to get them back to Snow Hill, where his mama lived. Even after he had taken the sharecropper job in Snow Hill, the black hadn't faded, and for Angel, Daddy was forever fixed in her mind as a raccoon, a comic strip animal with a headlight on his hat. The sharecropper's shack was a lesser place even than the old crumbling miner's row house in Paris. Once they had settled in Snow Hill, Mama had lost all of her yearning to fix things up. Daddy didn't seem to notice a thing about her, not the way she stared out the window or left supper dishes dirty in the tub until sunup. As far as Thorn Welby was concerned, while Lemuel had stuck more magazine pages to the wall to cover the cracks in the pine, he'd hauled off and turned his back to the cracks in their everyday lives. Lemuel Welby had stared at Thorne's picture the morning he had packed them all off with Lana. He had said no farewells, only how he wished that Mama had stayed to take on her share of the load. Angel had tried to keep everyone's mind off Daddy, and prattled about movie stars and life in California the morning they all gathered up their few belongings. But she saw the way he leaned against the doorpost with his face toward Little Rock. That was her last memory of Daddy. Dew, their uncle, had wrapped cornbread wedges in newspapers, one for each of them, and one each for him and Daddy for their lunch that day. Dew had a stingy way of hoarding his money in a woolen sock he shoved into his pocket, even while he slept. "That Dew, he would not part with a dime," she told Willie. "But he surprised me big time when he handed me $2 worth of change." Dew had gripped it in his field-blackened hand above her own hand, and then finally released it as though it would be the end of his worries about them. But Dew's guilt had settled along the misty rims of his eyes, pink circles carved out of a dusty cotton picker's face. Like Lemuel, Dew had lost all of his childhood brilliance down in the throat of the mines, where little children laid aside notions of playthings and make-believe. The cotton fields had taken whatever was left. Angel kept Claudia's last letter in a cotton drawstring bag on a string around her neck. the letter that told all of them she and her husband had settled in Nazareth with baby number 2 on the way. She said, by now, Claudia's baby must be, what, walking around, getting into trouble? That makes me Aunt Angel. She liked the sound of it. Ida May did not answer. Willie watched the drifter boys steal a chicken and disappear into a forest beyond a herd of skinny cattle. A distant train whistle spoke of too many young fellers that now lived, breathed, and traveled the rails. Angel promised Willie and Ida May that it was a matter of an hour until they reached Claudia's house, but it only proved to be another of her inventions. The rolling sky dumped rain onto their heads while great strains of thunder pounded from south to north. The sky let out its robes and dropped its liquid children to the earth, hard enough to pound the hollows and the creeks, but not enough to lift the drought from the dry lips of the farmland. Angel ran, yelling at her siblings to keep up. The long, hot day had lasted longer than most other days in her estimation. It would end with this drench in rainfall and cover the rest of the day like night. While she might otherwise have welcomed the wet respite from the summer heat if she had been in the cab of her uncle's truck, a muddy trek through a snaky field left her closer to tears than she dared to admit. Ida May was already full-blown bawling like a calf. If she herself lost it, they'd all end up sitting down and crying their heads off.
I see a shack ahead. Let's see if it's unlocked.
Angel slowed to allow Ida May to catch up, but Willie kept running until he disappeared entirely into the old one-room hovel.
We got us a house, said Ida May. I like it. It's not our house, and it's not a house anyway.
Angel pushed back the tattered curtain from a window to let in what little light remained. It's a shed or some such, but we can stay here and listen for the next ride. Then we'll hitch it all the way to Nazareth. She said it like a veteran of the highway. The rain fell, and Angel lost track of the time until night ascended. All three of them peered over the windowsill as a black automobile motored up over the hill with headlights penetrating the curtain of rain. She was about to shout when Willie gripped her arm.
Angel, the last person we hitched a ride with took everything we owned.
Angel watched the hulking vehicle slow, split a muddy hole in the road, and then pass.
We can't stay here. What will we eat, Willie? If we can just make it to Claudia's before morning, it's bacon and fixings when we get up.
Ida May, for the third time, described her hunger in pictures like she was a little rabbit soon to be killed and forgotten along the roadway. It wasn't long until Angel saw another set of headlights.
You two stay inside. I'll flag this next one down. If things look bad, I'll run off and hide in the woods. But don't come after me if that happens. Just wait and I'll be back. Angel Welby, you're just a big nut for doing it, said Willie. I'm going with you.
Ida May watched out the window next to Angel, but pinched Angel's sleeve as though she would not let go.
Ida May, you stay here with Willie.
Angel lifted the curtain rod and pulled the curtain off to take for a head covering in the rain. She left them behind to gripe to one another. Lightning flashed and outlined the approaching truck. The cab had a smallish appearance. The lights drew closer to the shack, but Angel stepped behind a cluster of bushes. Willie's worry had unnerved her. But before the truck reached her, it slowed, careened onto an open field, and stopped. She watched the driver inside the cab. He appeared to dig through some items. Then he pulled out a blanket and laid down, apparently to sleep for the night. The truck bed was loaded with supplies and covered with a tarp.
Angel burst back into the shack. Come with me. While this driver catches some shut-eye, we'll climb under his tarp and sleep. He's got grub. Everything we need. I'll bet you a dollar. He'll see us anyway. Why don't we just ask him for a ride and see how he takes to it? Asked Willie. If he turns us down, it might be the last chance we get all night. We've been here all day and seen only two automobiles. You coming or staying?
Ida May headed for the door.
I'll come, but if this fella cuts our throats while we sleep, you'll be the blame for it, Angel.
Willie opened the door. Angel led them down a shadowy path through brush and trees until they were within a few yards of the truck. The driver had already fallen asleep. She lifted a corner of the tarp and helped Ida May hide beneath it.
Apples! Oh, my! Apples! Said Ida May.
Angel peered over the crate of apples, the flour and sugar from the store in Camden, and the bed of the Ford truck. It had the same smell as her daddy's dirty wash on laundry day. Rain pelted the tarp, but it was dry underneath. She smiled. You'll never believe this, she said. We found Sweet Eyes.
He'll be one surprised gentleman come morning.
Chapter 2. The storm outside Camden steadied to a vertical shower, a soothing beating against the truck windshield, 100 fingers drumming on the truck top. Jeb stretched out on the truck seat. He shifted to his right side, still bruised from Hank's lucky left jab, and turned his back to the night. The left side of his jaw was raw, but not from a lucky punch. Charlie had cut his hair away from his face and shaved him clean as a girl. The storm quieted like a grandma's hum. The truck lurched beneath him. It felt like the wind had blown against the tarp and caused the supplies in the truck bed to tremble. Jeb pushed back the brim of his hat and lifted his eyes to the window, but the sodden field encircled him, empty of life. Not even the mottled patches of depression-starved cows remained. All creatures safe in the distant barns, all hearts asleep in bed. Only a wanderer dared sleep in the rain. He dozed off. The rain had taken Jeb's appetite from him. He slid upright, stiff from a night on the truck seat, and started the engine. He'd traveled 5 miles when he heard the cry of a child. It was a young'un's cry, he knew. It reminded him of his little sister back in Temple, Texas, when, at the age of 4, she'd fought her weaning. The subtle wail he heard through the open window grew louder and quivered, like a youngster chased by terror. He slowed the truck, although he had no interest in family entanglements. But children fell into wells or down old mining shafts, he told himself. I'd be a sorry sort to ignore it. Jeb slowed some more. Black-eyed Susans smelled bitter along the dirt road, sloppy wet with long green necks bent sideways from the all-night deluge of rain. A mongrel putted past his door, glanced up at him, and then loped ahead at the sound of a boy's whistle on the wing of morning. The tires lumbered slowly over a slick road pimpled by stones. Jeb heard mockingbird and finch and the remote mutter of thunder as the storm moved away from western Arkansas. But no cries. Must imagined it. The storm had soaked every stick of kindling, so the idea of cooking so much as a piece or two of bacon was out. The truck shimmied. A thudding sound, louder than a spilled crate of apples, banged from under the truck bed tarp. Some animal has got into my grub, Jeb said. The earliest peep of sunlight made his eyes feel like two burned-out headlights. He pulled to the side of the road. Behind the seat, Charlie had tucked a rifle. But at close range, Big Brother's rabbit blaster would shatter a raccoon to ashes. He slid it out anyway. Untying a corner of the tarp,
He lifted the edge with the butt of the gun with the same caution with which he might look into a snake hole. Three pairs of eyes stared back at him with that trapped fox of a look. The youngest child, a girl about six, small like an understuffed rag doll, had smudges around her red eyes like little boys who play soldier. She jerked away from an older girl who bore a clear look of familiar about her. "What's this? Kids? Get out of there!" The boy in the group yelled, "Run, he's got a gun!" while the oldest girl continued biting into one of Jeb's apples. "You hear what I say?" he said to the oldest. The boy and the youngest girl scrambled over the back and ran down the road, slowing only when they realized the leader of their brood had lagged behind. She shrugged. "You won't shoot." The folly of a standoff with an 80-pound refugee caused Jeb to lift his rifle parallel to the ground and polish the butt with one hand. "Don't think I won't."
"You won't. I saw you back in Camden. You ain't the shooting type."
"Oh, that's where I saw you. Don't tell me you kids rode in the back all the way from Camden." Then he remembered stopping along the way for a dinner of beans and bread out of the truck bed.
"Angel, you lost your mind? Let's go," the boy called to her.
"Angel? Ain't that a misleading notion?" Jeb said.
"Shut up, Willie. Don't you be giving away my name."
Angel had a hoarse cough. So much of her hair was caked in road silt that the color had lost all sense of description. "Angel, Willie, and who is the little one?" asked Jeb.
"Ida May. She's my sister. We need to ride only as far as Nazareth."
Angel pushed herself up, her knees two dirty knobs, and hurled the apple core into the field. "You've been eating my grub. Them eats was supposed to last me for a good week or two. You heard of the depression, I reckon. You think I got money to burn?"
"That woman you hooked us up with, she weren't no teacher. She was a con, and she stole every penny we had on us."
"That nice teacher lady? I don't believe it." But he wouldn't take the blame for hooking them up.
"How else you think we ended up dumped on the side of the road?"
"That was the way of things. Had nothing to do with me. Now you eat up my stash and got the nerve to ask for more? Back where I come from, we call people like you a mooch. You just climb out the way you climbed in and go beg at one of these farmhouses. Some farmer's wife, she's your best bet for help. I got places to go. No time for varmints."
"Where you come from?"
Angel leaned over the back of the truck and helped Ida May back in, as though she had no intention of leaving.
"Don't you hear anything I say? You got a name, don't you? Fine. I'll just haul your rear ends out myself. You, girl, get your hands out of that sack of bread loaves."
He yelled at Ida May. She wailed. Jeb hated the sound of her cry, a wounded girl sound, like a young one too long away from her mother.
"He didn't look mean at first. Maybe I was wrong about him."
Angel lifted the hem of her dress and wiped her sister's eyes with no care for showing the hem of her drawers. The boy stood at a safe distance, skipping stones, pacing.
"I never seen a man with so much trouble in his face. You in trouble?"
Angel seemed to notice her dirty cuticles all of a sudden. "I said get out of my truck. I've lost all patience with you, girl." Jeb ran to the rear of the truck bed. Angel clambered over the crates, but Ida May wasn't fast enough. Jeb grabbed her by the collar. Willie swore and leaped onto Jeb's right arm.
"Let her go, 'fore I get mad."
Jeb shook the boy loose and dumped him onto the muddy road.
"You's mean, that's what," said Angel, "like I figured."
Jeb lifted the smallest girl from the truck bed. Before he could climb in after the oldest child, he saw a vehicle approaching.
On the side of the vehicle were words he could not make out, but it looked to be the law. An idea came to him. You two get in the cab and don't say a word.
Don't, Willie. It's a trick.
Angel shaded her eyes and saw the copper's car, too. Go now, or I'll leave you all on the side of the road. You said you wanted a lift. You taking it or not? He lifted Ida May over one shoulder and ran with her to the passenger side of the cab. While he tossed her inside, the boy griped at him for touching his sister. Willie, if ever somebody offers you a handout, it's best you take it. Might be a long time before you get such a thing again. Willie stepped back and watched for his sister's response.
Go on and get inside, I guess, said Angel.
She climbed out and joined her brother and sister. Jeb tied down the tarp again and jumped inside, just as the law pulled up beside him.
Everything all right?
The officer looked to be a deputy or some such, a portly man who stuffed ham biscuits into his mouth like everybody had plenty. He spoke with a jewel of Mayhaw jelly on the corner of his mouth.
You look like you got trouble, mister.
Angel would not cut eyes at the deputy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.